Okay, looking at a newspaper article that's an online newspaper thing from the St. Louis Post-Dispatch. I'm going to put a link below, but it's entitled Police Shut Down Mysterious Oathkeepers Guarding Rooftops in Downtown Ferguson. Pictures on this are very telling. It shows veterans or guys, you know, guys with gear and weapons that are on rooftops. Apparently they allowed a reporter up there to take pictures, which might not have been the wisest course of action for somebody who understands, you know, what embedded reporters do. But this was done. And it also demonstrates that when these guys are above the ground level, not engaged in any shouting or protesting or bullhorning or any of that kind of stuff, that they, you know, they're on these buildings, they're minding their own business, they're doing a watch. They allowed cameras up there probably to prove themselves innocent as far as any rules of engagement or accusations of rules of engagement being abused or something like that. Is probably why they said, okay, reporters can come up here in small numbers and take pictures. And then, of course, they get labeled as the bad guys. Stuart Rhodes has made a statement that his people would be returning as protesters because the order to get off the rooftops came from the police. I tried to explain before that what happens is that the factions will make demands through the faction that they're across the table with. And, I mean, what this smells like is somebody said, listen, we're afraid of these guys who are up on a roof with rifles. Why don't you get them off of there? So when that happens, I have to repeat myself that there has to be, for the Patriot Movement people, there has to be a very strong perception that you're not taking sides in the other people's conflict. So re-engaging as protesters, I think, is counterproductive. I think you need to stay the course with the private volunteer security situation and simply change the title to volunteer firefighting. The rooftop thing is a good idea. Whoever came up with boarding up all the lower floors, just boarding everything up, having one entry or something like that, and then being on a rooftop, I think that was a really good idea. Whoever the boots on the ground guy is that came up with that, came up with something that I wasn't initially thinking was possible, but now that I see how those buildings are put together and where they're positioned on the street, that's a very good idea. I think is a level of defense on that, keeping some of the businesses open but boarded up because there's, you know, doors and guards there. Very good idea. The other thing is that, you know, gaining the explicit consent of the owners and occupants, lawful occupants of those buildings, has accomplished the mission of identifying who's got the biggest problem with these people having self-security. We've seen in relatively recent history situations where the lawful authority that was involved in one end of a negotiation in disputed territory had decided that they were going to redraw maps with an opposing faction at the negotiating table. One of the factions says, well, listen, we've got these people building homes and settlements in this area. We want you to redraw the maps and kick them out. That was done. And then there were people from that faction who said, listen, you're no longer our government or our authority if you're going to negotiate away our homes, our property, and our businesses to the riot mob. And that was when Yitzhak Rabin was removed from office with extreme prejudice, removed from office with extreme prejudice. And that was how that went down. Now, at this stage, there's no indication that any officials with the Justice Department had negotiated, or the local police department had negotiated with the rioters to say, we need you to clear out this, this, and this target as payment, as a tribute payment to the riot mob, and then we'll refrain from hitting the police station. However, a buildup of evidence is going to start looking more like that if the security is removed from those locations and they end up looted and burned, but the police station isn't attacked. Okay, it's going to look like somebody made a deal to say, okay, hit this, and that street and that strip mall, but don't hit City Hall. I was very specific in the advice that I gave that if Chon Quayle and his new Black Panther Party and the rioters and all these people have a problem with the government, they have a problem with the police, they have a problem with City Hall, and you're guarding the non-combatant, disinvolved locations, and point them, you know, City Hall and the police department are that way. There's no authority that has the authority to give those people permission to loot and burn the locations that you're guarding. The removal of the security from these locations is a tactic to say, hey, let's get these people involved in looting and burning so that they don't hit the police station and City Hall, is the tactic of a government on the downfall. And when we look at the media as the fifth estate, as a function of that, then we also have to look at the fact that we now have a public record that there was a call for the removal of security from uninvolved places, uninvolved apartments, uninvolved stores, security, stuff like that. Now, whether or not somebody wants to create an obligation on the part of the Oathkeepers, who at one point had volunteered to go there and guard those locations, it might be scared away from it. It's not my place from Camp Living Room to tell them to stand out in the cold and fight to the death over somebody else's private property. However, if somebody decides to do that, then that is a true answer to the warrior calling in a defense of this country, in a defense of things that we should value. On the other hand, if there's a change of tactics, let's say from the tactical look to these are volunteer firefighters doing observation, anybody with a fire, you know, anybody with a few buckets of water and a fire extinguisher can say, well, we're here as volunteer firefighters, and simply keep weapons out of sight and out of mind in that regard. I would be curious if somebody's going to be against that too, because remember, if things cross the threshold where somebody has acting out what appears to have been a backroom deal to clear the way for a riot mob to loot and burn other locations in order to appease them from attacking government infrastructure, then that is an abdication of authority. And that's a problem. These people need to concentrate their efforts on each other. These are combatant factions who need to concentrate their efforts on each other. And participation in either side, I think, is not good. I think just because I said, listen, I wouldn't stand shoulder to shoulder with the police in this regard, I don't think you should be standing shoulder to shoulder with the protesters either, because they're simply another arm of the riot mob. They're simply the slightly more peaceful arm of the riot mob. And there's plenty of ways to get a protest message across without necessarily doing what they're doing. Now, I understand there's a lot of locking arm and peaceful stunts as far as let's lock arms and sing Kumbaya at the mall to stop people from shopping for 5 minutes and think about police brutality. I understand that. I'm not against that. But when you are in command of an armed organization that has a lot of good functional tactical capability, there is a certain level of maintaining the focus. And I'm not saying that your tool is a hammer, therefore everything else is a nail, but there shouldn't be a loss of focus on the protection of lives and property when the protection of lives and property under situation appears to have been abdicated by local authorities who may be facilitating the means by which a riot mob would be able to loot and burn those locations. And it's personal choice in whether that's the time and a place where you want to make your stand. Again, from Camp Living Room, I'm not going to command anybody to give up their life over somebody else's property like that. It's not my place to do that. It is my place to recognize what's happened here for what it is. And that's where somebody very quickly piped up an objection to private security, whether or not, you know, was fully licensed in the state of Missouri. People who stepped up to prevent the looting and burning of private businesses and property, which have absolutely nothing to do with the police brutality problem or abuse problems there. We do know that certain levels of rioting and looting apparently had the appearance of being allowed as an appeasement tactic to the riot mob. That is something which is done tactically. The legitimacy of it is disputable, but the fact is, I'm not in command of a police department there, neither is anybody in the Oathkeepers, so it's very difficult to judge that particular action when they said, listen, their priority is to secure government buildings and a police station. I understand that, but that priority ends with the abdication of security for the private locations which are being secured by the Oath Keepers. The only time that there's going to be any legitimacy on a removal of the Oath Keepers' security from those rooftops is when they're being replaced by adequate state security of one form or another. Now, it complicates that a little bit because a lot of the Oath Keepers are apparently off-duty law enforcement people or federal agents. Now, we have a historic precedent for volunteer, off-duty, and retired law enforcement and army people and all of that in the manhunt for Eric Rudolph in the late 90s to early 2000s. A lot of them had volunteered to beat bushes in, what was it, the Carolinas or Virginias or whatever, where they thought Eric Rudolph was hiding. And that was an ongoing activity before the existence of the Oath Keepers. there were volunteer, off-duty, and retired law enforcement people that assisted in the search for Eric Rudolph. I don't know if it's the exact same people or a similar type pattern program that's been involved with the Oath Keeper security at those private locations in Missouri. What we do know is the official action to remove them from that is a adversarial action, not just to the Oathkeeper organization, but to the potential victims of the looting and burning. But it's difficult for us to say, yes, that's what it is, unless that looting and burning actually takes place. And it's an ugly thing to tell these poor people that have their humble businesses with a little apartment above it that, oh, I'm sorry, we have to watch your place get looted and burned in order to prove a point. It's a very difficult situation. I can only watch. I'm 1,000 miles away. I'm welcome to more discussion, more boots on the ground commentary to see what's going on with that.